I am Attila Turzo, an international master from Hungary. This is the second part of the series on the Scotch game. The starting position appears after white starts with e2, e4, black plays e7, e5, knight f3, knight c6, and in this position white plays d2, d4, opening up the center, attacking the e5 pawn. Black should capture on d4 with the pawn, then the knight takes back on d4. From this point, black can decide to play the knight f6 line, which is the most popular, or also the bishop c5 line, which nearly as popular as knight f6, or in this position also possible to play an interesting attacking idea, the queen h4 move. This will be the theme of this lecture. After this move, black attacks the e4 pawn and also the f2 pawn, and also he is ready to play bishop c5 with the idea of attacking the d4 knight and also having pressure on f2 pawn. What should white do in this position? I think the best idea is to develop with the b1 knight. Knight c3 defends the e4 pawn, and then white is ready to develop the bishops and then castle as soon as possible and try to have development advantage and even ready to sacrifice material for that. Black can play here bishop c5 following his original idea, but after bishop c5 I think bishop e3 developing move is very good for white, because he defended the d4 knight and ready to play bishop e2 and castling short. The more crucial way to play for here for black is bishop b4. By bishop b4, black pins the c3 knight and threatening again to capture on e4. And I think this is the moment when the best to sacrifice the e4 pawn for development advantage. What's the disadvantage of the bishop of the queen h4 move? After queen h4, the c7 pawn became weak because that was defended only by the queen. So many times white can play the knight on b5 to attack the c7 pawn and also threatening with the knight fork on the a8 rook and the e8 king. So that's one important counter-attacking idea, the knight b5 move, attacking on c7 pawn. But before that, I think the best to continue the development is bishop e2 and sacrificing the e4 pawn. Why not defend the pawn? Because the f pawn cannot defend because that's pinned. The bishop d3 is not possible because the d4 knight is hanging. If white defends with the queen, then black can attack with one more time, and then there is no more good defense on the pawn. And black wins the pawn and even has a nice development by castling. So time to play bishop e2 here, giving up the pawn but getting nice counterplay. Here black captured the e4 pawn with the queen and attacking one more pawn, attacking the g2 pawn and also the d4 knight. It looks like black has an excellent position. He's attacking and also he has already a pawn advantage. But the truth is now white has a very strong move. He can attack the c7 pawn with the knight and save the d4 knight, and this is a very strong threat. Because what happens if black captures one more pawn? That's a poisoned pawn, because now white can play bishop f3, defending the h1 rook and also attacking the queen, and in the same time attacking on c7, so if black moves the queen, then white wins the rook on a8 and having winning position. So the black queen cannot capture on g2. What can he do? You need to solve the problem of the c7 pawn. He can do it on two different ways. He can try to defend it with the king, king d8, or can try to defend with the bishop from a5. One more way is possible, but that loses instantly the queen e5 move, because white can attack the queen and then the queen cannot defend it anymore. f2, f4 move wins, because the queen should move and then white captures on c7 and wins the rook. So queen a5 is not possible. What happens if the bishop defends? After bishop a5, white has also an instant win, because now the bishop is overloaded. He should protect the c7 pawn, and also the bishop should pin the c3 knight, because other way the c3 knight would win the queen. So white can use the trouble of the bishop by capturing on c7 and winning the rook, because the bishop cannot really capture the knight, because then the c3 knight would capture the e4 queen. So after we looked at two alternatives, we figure out the only good move would be to defend c7 with king d8, but also black may have an in-between move, and he can first capture with check on c3, which most of the players do, by giving the possibility for white to capturing back with the knight, preventing the double pawns, but then the c7 problem would be solved for black. So here white should capture back with the pawn. And if you look at the pawn structure, it looks quite bad for white, because he has double pawns and isolated pawn on a2. And also black has a pawn advantage. But what's the compensation for white? The c7 pawn, the problem of the c7 pawn, which should be played king d8 to defend the pawn. Now white can castle, and from now what can be the plan for white? White has small development advantage. He already castled, developed the bishop and the knight. Black only developed the queen and the knight. And also the queen can be attacked later, maybe with rook e1 or bishop f3, so needs one more move to have a safe position. And the other important thing is the d8 king. So the black king is in the middle, and it's a very vulnerable place. White can attack on the d5, also maybe later can use the b5 for the rook. If the c8 bishop would like to develop after d6, then many times the d6 pawn would be a target after, for example, bishop a3, and sometimes sacrifice on d6 with the knight or with the bishop. Also, on the e5, the rook has very big pressure on the black position. In this position, black can attack the knight with a6, or also can develop the other knight with knight f6. Let us look at the a6 move first. So if the pawn attacks the knight, then white should come back to d4. And after knight d4, the white knight has very nice place in the center. Many times it's written into play now bishop f3 and then capturing on c6, because the d7 pawn is pinned. For example, if black would be not so careful and playing d6, then bishop f6 would win back immediately the pawn on c6, and still the black king would have a bad position in the center. But here I think the best move for black is to capture the knight, to solve the problem immediately, and white can capture back with the pawn, and now the pawn structure is better for white than before, because now the pawns are not doubles, and also those pawns can be a good weapon against the black king by advancing them and trying to opening the file. If black continue the development in knight f6, then white can take the queen by bishop f3 and also looking for the b7 pawn, and the black queen can go back to f5, and here we can start to advance the pawn with c4. Black may try to develop the bishop with d6, then queen b3 attacking the b7 pawn, rook b8, then the other rook can be developed on e1, then the bishop can be developed to a3, and then the white plan can be to play d4, d5 to fix the d6 pawn, and then c4, c5 to try to open up the position by exchanging pawns. The a1 rook can go to d1 or to c1 to having pressure on the black position. So this variation may happen if black plays a6 and forcing the white knight to d4 in the beginning, but also black can decide to develop the knight to f6 and try to develop as fast as possible, maybe also the rook to e8, having a solid position, and later he would like to exchange pieces and in the endgame to win by the extra pawn. White would like to prevent the exchange of the queens and would like to have a strong attack on the king and somehow forcing to win material or giving a mate. The knight f6, white can play the rook to e1, always having the possibility to move the bishop somewhere to opening the file and attacking the queen. Black may play rook e8, looking for e1 and preventing the instant move of the bishop. And I think in this position, bishop a3 is a good move, with the idea of looking for the d6 pawn, and also now opened up the position for the other rook. Example, if black plays d6, and there is a very nice win immediately for white, because there is very big pressure on d6 and on c7. White can catch on c7, and if the king captures back, then queen d6 gives a winning position for white. Black cannot prevent the mate, after king, the king is under heavy fire. After king b6, the rook may go to b1, and the only possibility for black is king a5, and then the queen and the rook gives the mate with a good cooperation. And look, the black king right to the mating position from e8 to a3. Now the queen gives the mate, queen b3. So this may happen if black plays d6, natural move. And also if he plays maybe a6 with the idea to prevent this, then after knight d4, white threatening to play queen d2 and then bishop f3, and I think also with rook d1 or rook b1 has a very nice pressure on the black's position. We go back to the beginning a little bit and look if there is some other important move. So in this position we can look also what happens if black simply defends the c7 pawn by king d8, Then why should do the similar way how we proceed in the other variation? We should castle, and now it's returning to capture the queen. If the black bishop captures on c3, then we can capture back with the pawn and we arrive to the same variation, but we would like to look what happens if black don't capture that knight and he plays queen g6. After queen g6, the c3 knight became a very active piece and have a great attack on the position. After knight d5, attacking the c7 pawn and also the b4 bishop. White has development advantage, and when we have development advantage, we should be very fast, and we should play very aggressively. Many times we even sacrifice more material, pawn or piece, to opening up the position to have a concrete attack or concrete combination. Especially when the king is in the center, white is ready sometimes to sacrifice a knight or a bishop on c7 or later maybe on d6 to giving up material for opening up the file and giving the mate. The black bishop should defend the c7 pawn, but then white can play bishop d2, trying to exchange the defender. The bishop should go back to b6, escape from the offer of the exchange, but then the white bishop go to f4, attack one more time the c7 pawn. And this is the position when black has no really more defense. He can play d6, which looks okay, but on d6 and on c7 the pressure will be that huge, then white will be ready to sacrifice material, a piece, for opening up the position and then have a winning position. But how to proceed? The white bishop, the light bishop, can cooperate with the other pieces to play bishop h5, attacking the queen and on f7, and also with that opening up the e5 for the rook. What can the black queen do? He can play maybe queen e6, trying to continuously defend the d6 pawn and also the f7 pawn. But after queen e6, white can develop one more piece to use for an attack. Can play rook e1, attacking the queen. The queen can go back to d7, still defend both pawns. But now, because of the huge number of developed pieces, white has a combination to opening up the files and the diagonals. Can capture on b6, opening up also the d5. Increasing the pressure on d6. Black capture back with the pawn. And now time to sacrifice for opening the position. So white can capture on d6. Black pawn capture back. And now one more good move needed for white. Bishop g4, attacking the queen and forcing him away from the defend of the d6, because white would like to capture on d6 with the queen, attacking the black king. Black can play f5 to try to block the bishop, but then one last sacrifice means to get bishop take f5, because now if black captures back, then white queen can come into action with queen take d6, check, threatening with queen c7 mate because of the e5 is controlled by the rook. If the queen comes back to defend on d7, then the white queen comes from another direction to give the mate. Plays queen f8. And now the only line and the last move for black is queen e8, and then we can give the mate by capturing the queen by the white queen, by queen captures e8. I think this was a nice example how we can use a development advantage in this variation. If we go back to the starting position of this variation, then we can have a very fast look on the basic ideas. White would like to play knight c3 to defend the pawn and also just to develop the knight, and then later would like to play bishop e2 and very fast castling, and knight b5 will be the crucial move to attack the c7 pawn, forcing the black king to d8, and later on the open e file and the d file would like to have a combined attack against the king. And many times when the black pawn plays d6, then there are some sacrifices from a3 with the bishop or from b5 with the knight. I wish you great nice games in this variation, and thank you for the attention in this lecture, and see you in the another lectures on the Scotch game.